Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's 15th meeting of 2021. I've received apologies from David Torrance for this morning's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed, thank you. Our second item today is an evidence session with the Minister for Mental Health and Wellbeing and the Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport as part of our inquiry into perinatal mental health. A welcome to the committee, Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Mental Health and Wellbeing from the Scottish Government, Mary Todd, Minister for Public Health, Women's Health and Sport, and joining them we've got Hugh Masters, Chair of the Perinatal and Infant Mental Health Programme Board for the Scottish Government, Ruth Christie, Head of Children, Young People and Families Unit, Improving Mental Health and Wellbeing, the Directorate for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care from the Scottish Government, and Kirsty Campbell, Head of Maternal and Infant Health, Improving Health and Wellbeing for the Directorate of Children and Families, and Carolyn Wilson, for the Unit of Health Supporting Mothers and Maternal and Child Health. Sorry about that. Ahead of asking questions, just to remind members that if they have got a supplementary question to anything another member is asking, just to use the chat box and put an R&L, try and take as many questions as time allows. So if I start things off, my questions to Kevin Stewart about the progress that's been made. So there was the Delivering Effective Services Needs Assessment and Service Recommendations report, which made 28 recommendations, and that was in 2019. I would like to ask just what the progress has been on those recommendations and how they've been put into policy. Minister?
Convener, I wonder if it's appropriate to make some opening remarks first before answering your question. Would that be okay?
That's fine. Sorry, I realised you had an open remarks to make, but carry on.
Thank you, Convener, and I welcome the opportunity for my colleague Marie Todd, Hugh Masters and I to assist the committee with the inquiry into perinatal mental health in Scotland. Before I begin, I'd like to thank everyone who responded to the inquiry, the huge range of responses from professionals, organisations and individuals, just how important the issue of perinatal mental health is right now, and I'm pleased to be able to provide my support by coming here today. I'd also like to express my gratitude to those who kindly shared their own personal experiences. By doing this, it helps us to open up the conversations, address any stigma, and most importantly, it helps us get a better understanding of what works well and what we need to do better. We recognise the impact that the pandemic has had on the mental health of new and expecting parents, and the responses to the inquiry highlight the sobering reality of what this can look like on a daily basis. As a government, we are making significant investments in our mental health services to encourage recovery and renewal as we emerge from the pandemic. It's from this context that I would like to share a brief summary of my vision for perinatal mental health in Scotland. Since 2019, the Perinatal and Infant Mental Health Programme Board has overseen investment across community perinatal mental health services, the third sector, mother and baby units, infant mental health services, and maternity and neonatal psychological interventions. In October, we published the new Perinatal and Infant Mental Health Programme Board Delivery Plan, which sets out the next steps in our ambitious and compelling long-term goal to not only develop and sustain perinatal and infant mental health services in the most challenging times, but also to ensure a systems approach to service development and delivery of these vital services. And we'll continue to build on the achievements of the Programme Board to offer the right kind of support to those who need it at the right time. This year, more young parents, infants, fathers and those who have previously experienced pregnancy and neonatal loss are receiving support thanks to the organisations funded through our small grants third sector fund. The Programme Board will also continue to have experience is at the very heart of service development, implementation and ongoing provision. And as I mentioned earlier, it is incredibly important to us that the service provision is led by the needs of women and families. Building on good practice and learning from positive and negative experiences of current services. We'll take forward the work of the new delivery plan in collaboration with our partners and ensure a continued focus on raising awareness, promoting understanding and reducing stigma. And I'm extremely grateful to our statutory and third sector services for their continued passion and cooperation in delivering our strategic aims during the pandemic. With continued collaborative working, we can offer invaluable support for perinatal and infant mental health services across Scotland to provide a lifeline to parents, carers and families when they need it most. The responses to the inquiry also touch on the subject of pregnancy and baby loss, and Marie Todd will answer questions on those issues today. And I'd like to assure the committee that the Scottish Government, Marie Todd and I, recognise the tragic impact of baby loss and the profound effect that this can have on the lives of the bereaved families. We're committed to ensuring that women and families are provided with the right information, care and support, taking into account their individual circumstances. I look forward to working closely with you all as we work on our important agenda for perinatal and mental health to ensure that we're not just listening to the women and families of Scotland, but that we inform our policies with their own lived experiences to deliver quality person-centred care. Thank you, Convener. And if I can turn to your question, I think we have made real progress in terms of delivery since the report, and have looked to its recommendations to move things forward. Since March of 2019, we've invested over £16 million in perinatal and infant mental health services to develop a range of different services from specialist acute inpatient through to third sector support to women and families in the perinatal period. And we're focused on ensuring equitable access to sustainable mental health support throughout folks' pregnancies. Also ensuring that we get it right during the perinatal period and in infancy. And at the heart of our approach has to be those voices of lived experience. And I'll probably say that again and again today, because I believe that that is immensely important in getting it right in terms of policy development and service delivery. The programme board is making good progress in terms of meeting the recommendations in delivering effective services. For example, providing £6 million of funding in 21-22 across all health boards to establish specialist community perinatal mental health teams. In health boards with over 3,000 births a year, we've also funded enhanced psychological support for maternity and neonatal settings. Five boards, five Greater Glasgow and Clyde, Lanarkshire and NHS Lothian amongst them, are also in the process of establishing dedicated multidisciplinary infant mental health teams, with the majority of others embedding an infant mental health focus from within their perinatal teams. We've funded increased staffing for mother and baby units and created the Mother and Baby Unit Family Fund, which supports families to visit their loved ones when in inpatient care. And we also established the Perinatal and Infant Mental Health Third Sector Fund, which so far has supported over 2,000 parents to be and infants. And that comes with £1.8 million of funding. But, Convener, beyond that, I think the other thing that the committee will be interested in is the what is going on in the ground. And we are looking very closely at the overview of service development across Scotland. That is improving. Some parts of the country were slow in using the resources that were allocated to them. But Hugh Masters, the board, and I have been in fairly regular contact with some boards in order to ensure that they're back in track. And on that front, we're looking at four key areas in terms of that service development: perinatal mental health, infant mental health, the neonatal psychological interventions in those larger boards, as I said, and most importantly, lived experience and the level of engagement that boards are having with parents and families around about service delivery.
So I want to come back to what you're saying. Obviously, we have spoken to some parents, and one of the things that has come up, as you've alluded to, is a difference in consistency throughout the country. And you have just mentioned there that you're looking at areas throughout Scotland and just checking that there is that consistency of service delivery. In terms of how you're actually gauging progress, are you able to tell me a little bit more? I mean, obviously you're doing this by getting, by the sounds of it, by getting feedback from mothers and fathers and their experience. What form is that taking?
Well, I think your question there covers a number of issues, convener. I think it would be fair to say that coming into post and looking at this, and looking at it from a constituency basis as well, you know, we can see quite clearly that some areas were doing better than others in terms of delivery, in terms of recruitment, and recruitment was key here in terms of developing some of these services. Some areas had used the resources that we had given them well. And it would be fair to say, convener, that some of the health boards had barely spent any money at all. Recruitment was slow, and the level of engagement with those folks with lived experience was poor. That has changed. I'm not saying everything in the garden is rosy, because I still think there's work to do in certain areas. But we're beginning to see recruitment of folks. The North worried me, Highland, Grampian, who were pretty slow. That is changing. They are now recruiting. Beyond that, from my own view, some of the levels of engagement there with families with lived experience were not as good as they should be. Convener, I met with the Latinum Women's Group in Aberdeenshire not so long ago, and I know that you yourself have had contact on a constituency basis from some of those folks. And, you know, they had mixed experiences of services, and they didn't feel that they were being listened to enough. I think that has changed. Highland have sent me just this week, after speaking to them later on last week, at work that they have been doing in terms of communicating and consulting with families, with the third sector, which shows real improvement, and their recruitment is getting better. So I'm a bit of a old-fashioned boy, convener, a bit simplistic, some would say. So what I've got is a set of report cards, which we will update all of the time, just to look at the progress that is being made across the country. And what I'm seeing in those in the overview is more greens than there were, some ambers where we have got to make further improvement, and less reds than there were at the very beginning. But the committee can be assured that I will continue to engage with those areas who have been a bit slow in terms of developing services and not quite good enough in terms of allowing those folks with lived experience help develop those services.
If Hugh Masters wants to come in to add to what you've said, Minister, Hugh, can I come to you?
Thank you very much, Convener. And just to add to that, in terms of the work of the Programme Board, you're absolutely right that one of the key drivers, and this really came from the maternal mental health change agents that I'd also want to pay tribute to in terms of the work they did in bringing this issue to the fore, was the need for a national approach, a national spread of services, and to avoid areas where perhaps those services weren't in place. So that was a key driver. As a programme board, we have identified executive leads in each board. We have asked them to set up implementation groups themselves, and we regularly monitor and ask for returns, as the Minister has said. We also do twice yearly visits, and we'll be doing them early next year. Just in terms of why maybe some areas have been, as the Minister said, slower to use the funding and to get services set up, it's clear that this is also setting up new services during a pandemic, which has been challenging for many places. But it's also that in different areas, they were at different stages of development. So in some areas, there were existing services, or rather individuals and professionals who were providing a service. So that could be built on. Moving forward, there's no doubt that we want to really focus on evaluating the impact of this next year as a key priority of the programme board, both in terms of hard data, but also in terms of the experience that women and families, and whether the services fit with what it is that they want and expect. I guess moving from the what, so what have we been able to do, to the so what, so what impact does it add? Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to hand over to my colleagues who are going to go into some of the detail on this. And obviously, colleagues, some of the questions will be more appropriate to Minister Marie Todd as well. So just keep those questions directed to the appropriate person. And of course, if individuals, both your officials or ministers, want to come in, then use the chat box and I'll make sure that I bring you in. So we want to look at support for at-risk and vulnerable women, and Sue Webber is going to lead on that. Sue.
Thank you very much, Convener. Most of the witnesses spoke to quite a very upsetting for many of us, and we heard of quite varying and in terms also how the services are set up for those people that know they're going to give birth to a stillborn, sadly, or indeed at that moment when they're having that conversation with the healthcare professional. So what improvements are being made to ensure that the bereaved parents are treated with compassion consistently across the country and in every health board? And then we're not re-traumatised as well when they're coming in to the services later on. So I think these are a really vulnerable group of people, and I'd like to know what support we're doing to really drill down and help them consistently, irrespective of where they live in Scotland.
Right, your sound was a little bit patchy there, but I imagine it's directed to Marie Todd. It's about consistency of approach to families and parents that have had a stillbirth and across the country. Can I come to Marie Todd? And obviously we'll try and get Sue's sound sorted.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Gillian Martin, and thank you, Sue Webber. Apologies, your sound, it was a little glitchy my end. The first thing to say is that the Scottish Government recognises the impact of baby loss, and it's absolutely clear that women who experience baby loss need to have the right information, the right care and support taken into account their personal circumstances. The loss of a baby at whatever stage of pregnancy is an absolute tragedy, which has a profound effect on families, and that does include on their mental health as well as their physical health. The Scottish Government recognises this, and we're very clear that women and their families need the right care and support, and there's a lot of work going on across the country to ensure that women and their families are provided with tailored care, including following NICE guidance and ARCOG guidance. In terms of consistency across the country, you'll be aware that we had have a programme, Best Start, which we have started to implement. It's an incredible programme which really essentially encourages family-centred care, person-centred care, flexible, suited to the needs of the individual. And that will undoubtedly improve the situation. Unfortunately, in terms of implementation, the pandemic has struck mid-implementation, and while some health boards were very far advanced in their work on this, other health boards were really at the early stages of implementing Best Start. We are keen to pick up Best Start from next year. We expect to see a great deal of improvement in consistency of services when that is applied across the country. There are also, we've been working with third sector organisations like SANS to develop the National Bereavement Care Pathways for Bereavement and Loss. And those pathways provide health professionals with evidence-based care pathways, and they describe the best practice for bereavement care. We're also working on rolling out those across the country. As I say, there's a great deal of work going on across the country. It has undoubtedly been impacted by the pandemic, but I think we're on the right path, and once we are able to fully implement Best Start, we will see progress in this front.
Thank you. Is this better?
That sounds a lot better.
Thank you. Sue.
No problem. So one of our witnesses that came to speak to us, Kat Berry, she suggested at our meeting a week ago that the timescales for implementation of the specialist baby loss units can and should be shortened. Do you think that's possible, Ms. Todd?
So I recognise the urgency to work on this. I absolutely do. And I recognise that for every individual affected by baby loss, it is an absolute trauma. And we do want to get it right for women as fast as we possibly can. I think it would be foolish of me to make promises, particularly today, as we are facing, this pandemic has not finished with us yet. We are facing further challenges which we had not predicted and had not expected. So although we have been living with uncertainty for the last couple of years, it seems to me it would be foolish for me to promise certainty over the next couple of months when it's very clear this week of all weeks that's just not possible. What I can do is assure that witness that I recognise the urgency, and we will work as fast as we can to ensure that every woman right across Scotland can access that flexible, person-centred, family-centred care when she needs it.
Thank you. Can I follow up, I suppose, from that as well, Marie, is just to make sure that you spoke a lot about women in that, but there's also the father, and I think that was one of the messages that came out as well, so it's just making sure that they're included. But in terms of also one other question is, there's all sorts of trauma that can happen during pregnancy that makes women reticent the subsequent visits that they come into the unit. And it's not always, sadly, really resulting in baby loss, but there's a lot of trauma that can take place during pregnancy. So what are we doing to ensure that the mental health of those women that are in that sort of traumatic group that have experienced something quite significant are taken into account in that perinatal period as well?
So you're absolutely right to highlight that baby loss impacts not just the mum, but it also impacts the father as well. And I did say very clearly that we talk about family-centred care. So I do include the father in that. And in fact, the entire extended family. Babies are born. And you know, you'll be aware I was an antenatal teacher before I came into politics. So I talked a lot about how sometimes babies are born in a medical event, but they are always born in a social event. So they are always born into a community, they are always born into a family, and the whole family and community will need support when things go wrong. The solution, we think, to many of these challenges and to many of the traumas that people face during pregnancy, because you're right, it is an uncertain time, and sometimes things don't go as expected. Since 2017, we've provided over £16 million in funding to support the implementation of Best Start. And the Best Start, that five-year plan for maternity and neonatal care, was published in 2017. As I said, it still remains a firm programme for government commitment. That person-centred, high-quality care for mums and babies throughout pregnancy, birth and following birth can have a marked effect on the life chances for women and babies and families, and on the healthy development of that child throughout their lives. It really is gold standard care that we're aiming for. It's truly family-centred care that will maximise the opportunities to establish building blocks for strong family relationships and for confident and capable parenting. Some of the cornerstones of that type of care would be continuity of carer, for example. And there's been a lot of discussion around continuity of carer with regard to baby loss, because it does make a significant impact and difference to the experience of the person and family who have lost a baby. We are continuing to introduce continuity of carer within maternity services, and that's the care that midwives have told us that they want to deliver. That's the type of care that midwives want to be involved in, but it's also the type of care that women have told us they want to receive. Mm-hmm. They want to build a relationship with a midwife, not just through their pregnancy, birth and beyond, but also in subsequent pregnancies. And where there has been loss or trauma in one pregnancy, that continuity of carer becomes absolutely vital in subsequent pregnancies.
Thank you, convener. That's great. Thanks.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to theme of care pathways. And Paul O'Kane. Paul, over to you.
Thank you, convener. I think, you know, just to maybe start off, last week we heard quite a lot of important evidence, and I think, as Sue Webber said, it was quite emotional at points to hear. We heard about the planned development of specialist baby loss units as well, which are obviously not anticipated to be kind of fully available across Scotland until 2024. So I suppose my kind of starting point would be just to understand what percentage of bereaved parents are getting access to a specialist bereavement midwife at this stage, and kind of what can we do to speed up that intervention around kind of specialist interventions, particularly those baby loss units?
So I think I'll bring in Kirsty Campbell to give you a more up-to-date, the most up-to-date picture that I possibly can of the delivery across the country. Kirsty, are you able to give them some up-to-date information on where we are at the moment and where we're hoping to head next year, early next year, although I am aware that we're in uncertain times again with regards to the pandemic? Kirsty.
Yes, happy to. So the Minister has already outlined what we are taking forward in terms of work to support women who've experienced a loss in relation to the National Bereavement Care Pathway. And the National Bereavement Care Pathway has been developed and co-produced with SANS and a number of other third sector organisations representing baby loss. And the Bereavement Care Pathway sets a sets out a package of standards for maternity units to aspire towards and to achieve in relation to delivering high quality bereavement care for women who've experienced a loss, and women and families, I should say, who've experienced a loss. And there's a number of elements to those standards, including taking a parent-led approach, providing training and supportive materials, emotional support, providing a bereavement lead-in boards, providing bereavement care facilities, having supportive and informed discussions, memory making, and so on and so forth. The bereavement care pathway has been piloted in four boards, and we commenced that piloting over 2 years ago. Unfortunately, the piloting has slowed and paused in some boards because of the impact of the pandemic. What we do know is that it hasn't stopped, but it has potentially slowed progress with the bereavement care pathway. Our bereavement care pathway lead, Catherine McRae, is working with the four boards that are on the pilot to try and continue to make that progress. We are really hopeful that given the progress that has already been made and the evaluation that's underway in relation to that implementation, we'll be able to roll out across all 14 health boards in Scotland in the early part of 2022. Obviously, that is dependent on capacity within boards, given the progress with the pandemic. So that's a key part of what we're doing, and what the introduction of the bereavement care pathway will do is provide a consistent approach in all boards to implementation of support for bereaved parents across Scotland.
Paul.
Thanks, convener. I think just in terms of the specific kind of percentages I'd asked for, perhaps if Minister is able to write to committee, that would be really helpful, just so we can have that kind of empirical data as well. So I would thank the Minister for that, and I notice she's agreeing, which is great. I suppose if I can just maybe pick up on a further point about kind of more specialised pathways for women, particularly perhaps around mental health and increased vulnerability, particularly kind of substance misuse issues. I suppose what specific pathways perhaps or interventions are being developed support people either in terms of poor mental health or indeed substance misuse?
So I guess it's the same approach. That best start approach equips midwives with the skills to care for women with socially complex needs and their babies. They have reduced caseloads, continuity of care, additional training, and clear pathways of care and coordinated multi-agency support. So the best start for any baby is that women receive continuity of care from a primary midwife who's supported by a small team. And that primary midwife is really important for women with additional complex needs like substance misuse. As I said, work's underway to produce nationally consistent guidance and pathways and to cope with, you know, different levels of complexity where, you know, lead carers, the midwife is always going to be the lead carer, but there may be a greater need to work closely with other services. Early access to care is really important, both for building that high quality antenatal relationship care between the mum and or the family and the midwife. And it's really important for both mum and baby. For women with a whole range of medical, social, psychological complexities, early intervention and coordinated multi-agency care makes a real difference. So it makes a massive difference to outcomes. And that begins at the booking appointment. So at the initial booking appointment, when the midwife first sees the mum during pregnancy, women are asked about a variety of wellbeing questions in order to assess their likelihood for additional needs. And I think it may be that you want my colleague Kevin Stewart to ask specifically about some of the perinatal mental health approaches antenatally and that support a woman from the antenatal period right through to postnatal period.
I'll bring in Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you very much, convener. The perinatal mental health Clinical Network has set out a series of five national pathways. And these pathways cover preconception advice, psychological support for mild to moderate concerns, specialist assessment for severe complex need, emergency assessment, MBU admission, and specialist assessment intervention for parent-infant relationship difficulties. We're developing animations at this moment to increase accessibility and awareness of all of that. Four health boards have fully developed local pathways for perinatal mental health, and a further seven boards have pathways in development. And additionally, boards are developing specific pathways on birth trauma, neonatal loss, anxiety, and needle phobia.
Thank you, Paul. Have you got another question, or will I move on to one of your colleagues?
No, Convener, that was most helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. And let me move on to questions from Stephanie Callaghan on access to services. Stephanie.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you to the panel for being here today. It was really reassuring, actually, to hear the Cabinet Secretary put such a clear commitment and focus on actually taking into account women's lived experience and making sure that there's equitable access across the country there. And you did just answer my first question there about where the boards were with that recommendation. So can I ask you, what's the Scottish Government doing to improve waiting times for perinatal mental health services and to align them with the time scales of pregnancy? And I'm also wondering whether the thresholds for referral to specialist mental health services have changed because of that increased demand. Thanks.
Minister.
Convener, I think, you know, I've gone on record many times. We don't want anybody waiting, and we are doing all that we possibly can to ensure that we are delivering for people, and will continue to invest in this recovery and renewal phase in terms of bringing waiting lists down, whether that's in CAM services or psychological therapy services. But here, you know, we have got to take the right actions. And in terms of service delivery, one of the key things which we need to do is to make sure that we have a joined up approach to dealing with perinatal mental health. So I think the work that we're doing and developing in health boards is extremely important, but we need to go much further in terms of ensuring that those folks in the front line know exactly what services are available and to direct folk to those services. So let me give you an example from discussions that I had with the Latin and women in the Northeast, where there were mixed responses to some of the questions that I asked. So, you know, it would be fair to say that some women thought that their GP services were absolutely fantastic in terms of getting it right for them. In other cases, folks were very, very unhappy indeed with their initial contact with GPs and were not signposted to the right services. We have got work to do in that. We need to change that, and we need to make sure that all we are doing across the country is being filtered down to those in the front line so that they know exactly what services women need and to signpost them and refer them on to them. I think, again, you know, in terms of the developing of services, what we require is not only those acute services, which we tend to concentrate on when we're talking about waiting times and waiting lists, but actually community services. We need to get it right in the communities across the country. Now, that means that the investment that we have put in needs to be spent wisely in terms of developing those community assets. But beyond that, we also need to ensure that our investment in the third sector is there to allow them, with their expertise, to play a real part in helping women and their families. So, for example, convener, in a constituency capacity, I met with Homestar Aberdeen on Friday, without doubt, as is always the case, we strayed on to some ministerial matters. These are folks that have got a lot of experience of dealing with women and families. And, you know, their experiences and the information that they're gathering has to lead to the improvements that are required to get it right for women and families right across the country. And quite possibly, convener, Hugh Masters will have something more to say in that for Ms Callaghan, I would imagine.
Hugh, would you like to come in?
Yes, I think the thing to bear in mind here is for the programme board next year, as I've said, this will be a key focus for us, is to see what are the access arrangements. A lot of these services, a lot of these developments are very new, and as such, we need to see what processes are being put in place to make sure that they're meeting at least the Managed Clinical Network for perinatal mental health, which is that it should be no longer than 6 weeks from time of referral to be seen. So, and we will target support to those boards where that as such is an issue. Just to go back to, if I could, just briefly on the pathways and substance misuse, I think it's really important that we are able, as the Minister has said, to make it clear and publicise that these services are now in place, so that people understand that that seeking help, that there will be help and support that are available. We're well aware of substance misuse. It's been identified in a number of settings, both from delivering effective services, the very first sort of report highlighting the need to develop services, from feedback from women and families. We are in the process of looking at the recommendations and the report from the Managed Clinical Network around supporting women, reducing harm. And we're going to be working with our stakeholders at an event early next year to look at how we take things forward. And that may include a specialist care pathway or not, but we're in the process of developing that, and early next year we will have the actions emanating from that. Thank you.
That's great. Thanks. Yep,
definitely. Sorry. If you want to ask your next question, thank you.
Yep, certainly. Thanks, convener. So just to be really clear, that's good and that's really positive information. So just to be really clear, the thresholds for referral haven't changed due to the increased demand then. And also another little question on the end of that there, what supports are there in place just now while people are actually waiting to waiting for referrals to come through?
Well, convener, there are a number of things, and again, we need to listen to the voice of lived experience in terms of how we shape services for the future. I'm going to refer back to the Latinum woman, and there were mixed opinions on various parts of service delivery. But one of the things which all of the folks who expressed an opinion said was that during the pandemic period, the Grampian Resilience Hub was absolutely fantastic in terms of responding to the needs of those women. Now, what we need to do is take the learning from that pandemic period, from the Grampian Resilience Hub, and see if we can replicate that across the board. There was something that went on there that obviously worked for those women, and if it works for them, it's likely to work for others. And that kind of service, you know, can be the same in a remote rural an island area as in an urban area, because in the main it is communication by telephone or by video call. But I think that that kind of thing is something that we need to look at in more depth. And I'll be honest with you, Convener, again, you know, these nuggets of information, these nuggets of good practice, we would not be picking up if we were not going out and talking to the voices of lived experience, which, you know, I want to continue to do. Maybe Hugh will want to add a little bit more onto that, Convener.
Hugh?
Yeah, just in terms of what support is available, meantime, of course, I think as the Minister has said, we're trying to invest in a range of services here. So whilst we're talking here more about specialist assessment and treatment, we're also looking at what support can be provided by the third sector. But also, we haven't really, well, we have touched on universal services, but of course, we are training, we are offering training to health visitors, to midwives around perinatal mental health, to give them that confidence to also be able to offer that support as well, to be able to assess properly, to understand the issues, and we're getting some very positive feedback on that too. So universal services have got a key role to play in this too. Thank you.
Thank you. Stephanie, can I bring in Emma Harper, who has got a specific question on this? Emma.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Convener. It's just a supplementary when we're talking about access. The Minister will be well aware, as coming from a northeast rural area, and so my thoughts are also with the northwest and the south of Scotland as well. So, are we monitoring the women who are accessing from rural areas and then tracking the care and the pathways associated with that? It's just to really highlight that the challenges for rural areas as well.
Minister.
Well, Convener, I'm a Toonser from the northeast rather than a country boy, but I well understand the difficulties that there often are in accessing services in rural and island communities as a point of date. I have to say, Convener, that we have to adapt in terms of service delivery. Boards are often the best places to know their area as well. However, you know, we want to make sure that in terms of the shaping of those services, that women and families are listened to around about their needs. I pointed out the Grampian Resilience Hub as possibly being a solution that could be replicated elsewhere, which I think would work as well in Dumfries and Galloway as it would in rural Aberdeenshire. And I think, you know, as the committee and certainly colleagues who have heard me before in a previous role, I'm a great believer in the exporting of best practice. So where we find best practice, we will be spreading that far and wide. I know that Hugh and his team on the board have been doing that anyway, but we'll continue to do that. And as I said earlier, you know, we will continue to look for those nuggets, that information from service users about what works for them and try and replicate that across the board. So, you know, we are going to, in this, as in every other area, look at the best practice. Some of that will need to be adapted for certain parts of the country in terms of delivery, but best practice and trying to ensure that, you know, the voices of lived experience and what their opinion of services is help shape them.
And Hugh would like to come back in.
Hugh, yeah.
Yes, thank you. Just in terms of that data and monitoring, and I assume in many ways you're referring there to admissions to mother and baby units. And of course, this is something we have a very keen eye on. We have some really quite recent data on which boards are admitting to mother and baby units, and where women are not being admitted to mother and baby units too, so they're being admitted to adult non-NBU settings. And one of our key things to do early next year is to interrogate that data further to understand what are the reasons behind that, and we're hopeful that we're going to get permission to look through the managed clinical network to be able to do that, so we understand better the choices that are available to women and make. Another key priority for us next year will be to really push on with regional aspects. As you'll appreciate, sometimes where the remote and rural areas where birth rates are low, the need for a dedicated team is not as such there. There'll be a much more a dispersed model. So we're very keen that these regional links are made, and certainly in the north of Scotland that's happening now, with Grampian Highland and the islands all beginning to come together to discuss that. Just on top of that, also we've funded and had a priority for Near Me during this pandemic, which has worked very well for those who obviously it suits, and third sector funding. And finally, for remote and rural, we are, of course, we did set up the Mother and Baby Unit Family Fund, which gives funding for people, for family and loved ones to be able to travel and stay when the mother is admitted to an NBU. So we appreciate that's not the answer to everything, but it certainly has been helping, and we're getting good feedback from that. Thank you.
Thank you. And the Minister wanted to come back in.
Yes, Convener, since mother and baby units have been mentioned, and I think it's important to maybe expand on some of our thoughts around about that. Delivering effective services recommended that the number of NBU beds in Scotland should be increased, and that this could be achieved through either expansion of the existing units or through the creation of a new third NBU unit in the north of Scotland. The delivering effective services also recommended that an options appraisal should be undertaken to determine the most appropriate way forward to increase the number of beds in Scotland, and that work is currently underway. A number of options are being considered, Convener, including the creation of a third mother and baby unit in the north, or the expansion of one or both of the existing units in Glasgow and Livingston. We have to look at a number of issues here, including equity of access, cost and safety, and the sustainability of the service, and all that needs to be considered as part of that options appraisal. My intention is that we will hold a public consultation, hopefully early in 2022, which will help inform that options appraisal and help inform the decision-making process. And we'll seek to engage as many stakeholders, particularly those folk with lived experience, engage with as many of these folks as we possibly can. And as Hugh has rightly pointed out, at the moment with the two existing units, recognising that folk from further afield, from Livingston and Glasgow, often have a fair bit to travel, we have put in place the Mother and Baby Unit Family Fund to help with travel expenses for families. So again, hopefully in the early part of next year, we can move even further forward on that front in terms of consulting folk about the future of mother and baby units.
Thank you, Minister. I'm going to move on to the issue of COVID-19 and the restrictions around that. And Sandesh Gohani has questions. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. We know that mental health across the United Kingdom deteriorated over the pandemic, especially during the lockdown. And we know that perinatal mental health has been difficult for all our women in Scotland, even before the pandemic, from stigma to not having a dedicated mother and baby ward that they were able to go to. My questions are going to focus around women who are from ethnic backgrounds. So my question is, what impact did COVID have expressly upon those of ethnic backgrounds? And what learning have we done to prevent that from happening again, with further restrictions possibly on the horizon?
No.
Convener, do you want me
to? Yeah, I think we'll probably go to Kevin Stewart first, and if Marie Todd wants to come in around just the antenatal care aspect of things, I can bring her in afterwards, if that's okay, Minister.
In terms of the pandemic period, convener, and perinatal, feedback from the third sector highlighted the difficulties that there were in navigating service delivery in a safe way during what has been very turbulent times. So to support the third sector, we funded additional support focused specifically on wellbeing issues. I think, again, you know, there is learning that we have had during the pandemic period, which I think, you know, we can utilise during future periods. The Grampian Resilience Hub being the prime example for all of that. In terms of the impacts on perinatal mental health support for ethnic minority women during the course of the pandemic period, I don't have anything specific in terms of information here today. I think we can have a look and see what information we hold and get back to the committee in that regard. And I'll pass on to Marie for some of the other issues that Dr. Gohani raised.
Thank you. Thanks, Kevin. Thanks, Gillian. So the pandemic shone a light on health inequalities, pre-existing health inequalities, but it also exacerbated them. And we've seen that in maternity care as well. So unfortunately, even in this day and age, the strongest predictor of the worst outcomes during pregnancy is your level of wealth. So people from areas where deprivation is high are more likely to have poorer outcomes. We do see also health inequalities along, precisely as Dr. Gohani says, along Black and minority ethnic lines as well. And outcomes from maternity and pregnancy are often poorer for women from Black and minority ethnic backgrounds. It is a difficult issue because in Scotland numbers are relatively small and outcomes are generally good. So largely outcomes are good from pregnancy in Scotland, and the numbers are quite small where things go wrong. So we aren't it is a challenging area to study, but this is somewhere where we work very closely with our neighbours in the other UK nations. And I'm going to bring Kirsty in to explain some of the work that's going on in England that we are benefiting from in terms of looking more closely at how we can meet the needs of Black and minority ethnic populations during pregnancy. Kirsty.
Thank you, Minister. So, as the Minister has highlighted, we know that we know from a variety of different reports and data and evidence that outcomes for women from deprived backgrounds and outcomes for women and babies from Black and minority ethnic backgrounds can be poorer. And what we also are expecting to see, and are already seeing, that this has been exacerbated by COVID, because we know that women from Black and minority ethnic backgrounds are more likely to catch COVID and to have severe symptoms from COVID, and that applies to pregnant women in that category as well. As the Minister has highlighted, in Scotland, our 14 health boards contribute to a number of UK-wide audits, including the Embrace audit, which is mothers and babies reducing risk through audit and confidential inquiry. And we participate in this audit as part of a four-country approach. We also are part of the Perinatal Mortality Review Tool development process, and also the National Neonatal Audit Programme and the National Maternal and Perinatal Audit. And a combination of all of these audits have really helped shine a light on some of these disparities in outcomes for women from Black and minority ethnic backgrounds and for women from deprived backgrounds. And the most recent NMPA report, which published back in early November, made a number of recommendations for health boards to take forward in relation to improving services and attempting to reduce some of those outcome inequalities. And we're going to be working very closely with health boards in the early parts of 2022, and as soon as health boards have the capacity to work with us on these things, and as the Minister had highlighted previously, obviously at the moment things are particularly difficult in relation to the latest challenges that are being presented by COVID, but as soon as health boards have capacity to work with us, we are looking to work with them to look at how we can implement some of the findings of this latest NMPA report. And the findings are very practical and very pragmatic, and it's really helpful to have them set out in a report attached to the evidence, so that we can really clearly make the links between the interventions that health boards can make and the outcomes for these women.
Right, the Minister for Mental Health would like to come in, and then Hugh Masters, Minister.
I'll let Hugh come in, Convener, and Hugh may cover what I was going to say.
Okay, Hugh.
Thank you very much. Just briefly, 2 points really. One on learning from the pandemic. I think it's been clear the evidence is gathering pace that the impact on young families has been particularly acute, and actually we're beginning to see evidence that it's the sort of whether our children 0 to 2 years perhaps where the parents report most difficulty. So during the pandemic we've worked with the Managed Clinical Network to advise statutory services in terms of provision and maintaining that, and also with the third sector, and they developed a directory of services, 99 of them, that continue to operate and see families in the pandemic. So that's been really important, and again, I pay tribute to the work that they've done during this time and continue to do that. In terms of ethnicity, we have an equality subgroup as part of the programme board that is currently looking and has identified ethnicity and cultural issues as something that we need to further develop, and we'll be doing that. I should, in the near future, I just wanted to highlight some third sector funding that we have awarded to an organisation, AMA Birth Companions, based in Glasgow, who do a lot of work in the perinatal period with women and families where English is not the first language. And they recently won the NHS Scotland Award for Diversity at the award ceremony. So, and we're looking to spread the learning from that project too across other areas. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sandesh.
Thank you, thank you, Convener. I suppose the important thing to say is that as we've heard, Black women are twice as likely to die during pregnancy. And ethnic minorities also less likely to get the COVID vaccine, so are at greater risk. And so these things combined certainly are cause for concern, but specifically on perinatal mental health, stigma is a big problem that can occur, especially in ethnic groups. And what I'm keen is to hear that we will be able to take forward the learnings from the NMPA report and put that into effect. Now, I appreciate it's not large numbers, but this really matters. We need to get ethnicity right. We've had a period where we've had some stability. Why have things not been put in place? I suppose the question is to Kirsty. And when you say capacity, what is it that we're waiting? When is it that you expect to be able to start helping people of ethnic minorities?
So I don't think that nothing has happened in health boards. So this report that came out in November follows on from previous reports that I've highlighted, exactly as you identified, the disparity in outcomes for women from Black and minority ethnic communities. We have done quite a wide range of awareness raising style events with members of the clinical community across Scotland, and making sure that the information that is in those reports is known about at a local level, and that care can be adjusted. At the beginning of the pandemic, when in particular some of the emerging concerns arose around the worsened outcomes for women from Black and minority ethnic background in pregnancy, the Chief Midwifery Officer at the time wrote to all health boards outlining some measures that they could take at that point in time to try and mitigate against some of the effects of the COVID pandemic, including a reduced threshold for extending care and for testing and a range of other things, including focusing where possible on giving these women as much continuity of care as is possible at that time, recognising some of the challenges that have faced the NHS in relation staffing over recent months associated with the pandemic. So there has been stuff that has happened. There is definitely more that needs to be done. There's no doubt about that. There's a lot more that can be done. And that's why we intend to work with boards in the early in the new year to start to instigate this. And we will start that work as soon as we can. And all that is holding us back at the moment is essentially monitoring where this current wave of COVID is going. And as members of the committee will know, maternity services remain as an essential service throughout the pandemic and have done. And that those babies are in the pipeline and maternity and neonatal care needs to continue. And boards have continued to do that through the challenging times that we've had, but we are very careful about not adding to the burden on them at a time when they are under such pressure. So we do want to move forward with this as quickly as possible.
And can I come to Minister Kevin Stewart?
Thank you very much, Convener. And I should say to the committee that we have just engaged a second participation officer specifically to link with minority ethnic communities and other equality groups as part of our work in listening to the voices of lived experience. I think, you know, Hugh already mentioned resources that we've given to the AMA women's group. We also have the Experts by Experience group who are working with AMINA Women Muslim Support Centre to understand their challenges better. And also in terms of our small grants funding, we have funded multicultural family base for peer support. I should also say to the committee that the equality impact assessments which we have done also highlighted issues around about stigma for BAME groups. But that stigma exists across all communities in this area, and we have got a huge amount of work to do across the board to ensure that we de-stigmatise perinatal mental health. That is going to take a lot of work, and I think, you know, we all need to work together to ensure that there is a greater understanding of the needs of women and families in this area. And that's why I'm grateful for the committee for carrying out this inquiry, because your findings will add to the information that we already have, and we need to act accordingly there. I think, you know, you have a situation whereby, you know, some women feel so stigmatised that they cannot even go into a bookshop to buy the information, to buy a book about the information around about how they're feeling. And that's one of the things about the small grants funds and the work of Latin women and others who are recognising these kind of things and ensuring that folks have easy access to these things. But for all of us, we should be working together to destigmatise all of us, whether that be in the BAME community or communities right across the board, Convener.
And I know that Emma Harper wants to lead on stigma later on in the session. Marie Todd wants to come in, but can I throw in another question since we've got Marie Todd's going to? But one of the things that came up from us, from the women that we spoke to, was that the COVID-19, obviously, and the restrictions meant their partners couldn't be there, and also in a lot of their appointments, but also they couldn't have antenatal classes, and that added additional pressure in terms of their pregnancy experience and it could impact on their mental health. And some of the women were, it was really quite emotional hearing the impact of not having their partner there, particularly if they were receiving not great news. So, I mean, as you said, we're not out of the pandemic yet. What assessments were made on the importance of having partners involved and antenatal classes? Minister.
So the first thing I wanted to do, if you'll indulge me for a moment, was to pick up on Sandesh Gulhani's point that there was low levels, perhaps, of uptake of vaccination amongst pregnant women from Black and minority ethnic backgrounds. And it is an opportunity for me to emphasise just how important vaccination against COVID-19 is during pregnancy. I think it's perfectly understandable that there was some hesitancy and concern in accepting a new product when it first came on the market over a year ago, but it has been used. Vaccinations against COVID-19 have now been used worldwide in millions and millions of pregnant women, and the evidence is very solidly that the benefits outweigh the risk. And one of the ways that we're approaching that to increase vaccination in that population who, particularly for Delta, appeared to be more susceptible than the rest of the population. One of the ways that we're approaching that is holding specialist vaccine clinics in maternity services. So you'll see, for example, Greater Glasgow and Clyde have been holding vaccine clinics for pregnant women. And those will, of course, also naturally, because of the catchment area, target Black and minority ethnic communities. I couldn't let the opportunity pass without emphasising just how important it is for our pregnant women to get vaccinated and to be fully vaccinated during pregnancy. They have every opportunity to talk to health professionals and to talk to the vaccinator if they have any concerns at all, but the evidence is very solidly behind vaccination during pregnancy now. In terms of your broader question, I suppose I'll start at the beginning, go back to March 2020 last year, and at the start of the pandemic, every service in the NHS pivoted to a digital response and face-to-face visiting was reduced. Those were the days before we had a vaccine, and things were very dangerous. Much of the way that we managed to get through the early pandemic was by pausing almost anything and everything. However, family nurses and health visitors worked really closely with local partners in designing perinatal and infant mental health pathways, making sure that the community continued to be looked after, recognising the importance of support for new parents and babies at a time of national emergency. Very few of these individuals were redeployed. So if you think back to March 2020, people were being redeployed from paediatrics, for example, into COVID wards, not largely our health visitors, not largely our family nurses, because we know how important it is to support women and families at these times. The importance of prioritising visits for new babies was emphasised, and the guidance was adapted throughout the pandemic. Where possible, there was an emphasis on returning to face-to-face visiting, but that hasn't been possible at every stage of the pandemic. And we've seen, you know, amazing adoption of digital options like NHS Near Me for antenatal checks, blood pressure monitoring, things like that. So support was continued. It wasn't always continued face to face. In terms of the importance of having partners there at significant appointments during the antenatal period and at the birth and postnatally, we've always recognised that and we've always tried to enable that to happen. There have been challenges in individual maternity units where there was insufficient space in the actual room for social distancing. So we had to leave flexibility for health boards where the risk assessment was that there could not be extra people in the room. But largely we have, absolutely throughout the pandemic, we have recognised just how important it is for women and their partners to go through these experiences together and to be able to support each other during antenatal appointments and birth and the postnatal period.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions around the workforce from Carol Mochan. Carol.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. And so far, thank you for all the input on this. I want to talk a wee bit about workforce, as the convener said. And one of the biggest things that struck me is that evidence from the Royal College of Nursing suggests that the biggest difference that we can make to improving this is actually around staff vacancies and workforce. It's one of the mental health is one of the areas where there is significant problems with workforce. And I know that, you know, the government are trying to address this, but it's quite important that we understand in this context just what the government are doing around workforce planning for specialist perinatal mental health services. Have they done anything around workforce planning? And also one of the key things that we hear from the nursing organisations is about retention of the really good, well-trained staff. And I wondered if you had any feedback on that.
Go to the Minister.
Thank you, convener. Workforce and sustainability have been at the very centre of all the programme board delivery plans. And last year, the Workforce Sustainability Group was established to explore the issue across all sectors of the perinatal and infant mental health services. NHS Education for Scotland have been expanding training places on commissioned programmes, as well as ensuring that additional perinatal and infant mental health training is provided across a range of professions. And that this will result in terms of our investments in 51 additional psychological practitioners by the end of 21-22. So there is a huge amount of work going on, not just in terms of that training and getting folk in, but also training others to recognise exactly what is required here. And as the committee well knows, across mental health services, I've said that we will look at a new workforce strategy for mental health within the first term of this, within the first half of this parliament. But in this area, you know, we are well on the way, and we can see that in terms of the recruits that we're managing to get in.
Thank you, Carol.
Yeah, thanks very much for that, Minister. And that, you know, obviously that is what we're looking for, is a training across the board. Can I just have a wee bit of clarity on the 51 practitioners? Is that new, or and is that across?
Well, that's additional practitioners across all services, Ms. Mochan. You know, these psychological practitioners, of course, will cover a range of services. But this is extremely important. That we get it right in this area, as in others. And I think, you know, having kept a very close eye in recruitment here, I think we're doing well. We also have to make sure that we retain these folks as we move forward, and we need to grow for the future.
Hello, are you happy?
That's lovely. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. Emma Harper has got a supplementary question on workforce. Emma.
Thanks, convener. Just wait until there you go. Thanks. Just wait until the camera comes on. It's just regarding the workforce and the provision of education. I know that there are education online learning programmes. RCGP has a perinatal mental health toolkit, and as I'm still accessing the TURAS learning modules myself, as a vaccinator, I checked the perinatal mental health modules, and there's 7 specific modules just with a quick search, and one is looking at stigma. And so I'm wondering, how do we track those modules? How do we track the uptake? Who's taken them up? Is it midwives? Is it psychologists? Is it GPs? Because these modules are, I think, are really, really fabulous. And so how do we then encourage our healthcare professionals to take up the e-learning modules, and how do we monitor that?
Convener, I don't have at my fingertips who is accessing all of these modules, but you know, we can get back to the committee around about the information that we hold. And I noticed that Hugh has put an R in the box, so he can maybe come in with some of the more detailed information that he's maybe got in his head that is not in front of me at the moment. But let me just say to the committee that we've worked with NHS Education Scotland, as I said to Ms Mochan earlier, to embed perinatal mental health within undergraduate education, to increase the numbers of psychology trainees at a postgraduate level, and to roll out that suite of materials that has been mentioned to make them accessible to all professionals across Scotland, to further develop expertise at all levels across both specialist and universal services. And importantly, you know, we have committed to investment in perinatal and infant mental health services beyond the life of the programme board. So that will allow boards to recruit the required staff on permanent contracts and supporting recruitment and retention of staff and the development of centres of expertise. But you know, that great expertise is grand, brilliant, but we also want others to be able to access the kind of educational materials that Emma is talking about. We have done that. In terms of details of who's accessing, if Hugh doesn't have the answer, we'll write to the committee.
Hugh.
Don't have the exact numbers, but as the Minister has said, we'll get back to you with that. But NES do have those exact numbers in terms of the number of people who have accessed the course, the number who have completed. So yes, we can get that exact breakdown. I just wanted to, if possible, just say I'm really glad that Ms Harper is accessing those materials. I've done so myself too. They are very, very well evaluated. We see constant evaluations from NES around that, and that they, whilst they're aimed at more the enhanced or specialist training end for the workforce, and that we feel was really important given the sudden surge in numbers of people who are going to work in perinatal. As you'll appreciate, a number of staff clearly have those skills in place, but for some it's a matter of developing them. So and that makes the post attractive and hopefully makes it somewhere they want to continue to work. But also those practitioners and others in universal services can also access specific modules. You've mentioned the stigma module as an introduction to perinatal too. So we know that that's also being accessed too. In general, what we're finding, as the Minister has said, with the recruitment, it's an attractive area to work. It's still difficult in some places and there are challenges, but on the whole, the teams are reaching their staff complement. And of course, we shouldn't forget, as we should never forget, is the third sector here too, and the issues that they have around sustainability and making sure that their staffing is what it should be. So we'll come back to you with that precise data. Thank you.
Convener, some very clever person has managed to get to me in terms of the stigma module alone. 700 practitioners completed that module.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Can I bring in very quickly, Sue Webber has got a quick supplementary question on workforce before we move on to questions from Gillian Mackay. Sue.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I'm just curious because NHS Lothian and some of the information we've got says that the government needs to invest further beyond the recommendations. And we've heard a lot about training and the staff, etc. So I'm just looking to get some assurance that there'll be a continuous reassessment of the workforce, what's needed, and the level of investment that will be needed. Could they talk quite candidly about the need to consider increased staffing complement to ensure that education, training, clinical supervision and support are embedded as part of practice and held in the same parity as direct clinical care? So it's all about making sure that self-development and improvement is included in their working time. So I was just wondering if the minister, probably Mr. Stewart, I think, might be best suited for that. Not sure. Minister.
We're continuing to monitor this as we move forward, not only myself, but also the programme board. I know that there are always calls for additional resources. That is the way of the world. What I'm very keen to see in all boards, I should say, is that the resources that have already been allocated for this work actually to be utilised and used. And it is that point that we would then look at to see whether other resourcing is required. So the key element for me at this moment to make sure that these recruitments are taking place, that that money is spent, and that the services that are being delivered are being shaped by the voices of lived experience. It's after that point, and after looking at the report cards that I talked about earlier, that then we can look at what else we need to do in what places. But I would ask all health boards to ensure that they are utilising the resources that they have already been given the max in the first instance.
Thank you. Move on to questions around joined up care from Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thank you, convener. What role do universal services play in the prevention of perinatal mental health problems, and how can these be strengthened or services better signposted? And could I put that to probably Minister Marie Todd first?
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you. Thanks, Gillian. So it'll come as no surprise that I believe that universal services are really key. They play a key role in prevention and in early detection of perinatal mental health problems from preconception onwards, public health messaging about awareness of mental health, positive health behaviours and health relationships has a really significant impact on later emotional well-being. All of the team, so midwives, health visitors, family nurse practitioners, all play a crucial role in identifying and preventing perinatal mental health problems. And that's why we've invested in the NEHS perinatal and infant mental health curricular framework that we've just been discussing, a whole suite of multidisciplinary training options to support universal and specialist staff to develop their knowledge and skills and to feel confident to address mental health and wellbeing issues with the women that they work with. All mental health staff, I believe, so you may want to discuss this further with Kevin Stewart, but I think that all mental health staff are able to access these modules as well, particularly those working in specialist areas with relevance. And if we look at the universal services, perinatal mental health is a fundamental part of the core curriculum. So we're trying hard to make sure that wherever you work and whatever your specialty is, perinatal mental health is an important part of your training and your continuing professional development as you go through the course of your working life.
And I'll bring in Kevin Stewart.
Thank you very much. Universal services are the key to all of this and ensuring that folks are able to access the services that they need. Obviously, delivery is often different in various parts of the country, but ensuring that we get this right for every woman, for every family, is absolutely essential as we move forward. Joined up care and a holistic approach is key for supporting women and their families during the perinatal period. And we're taking specific actions to improve that joined up services for women and families with complex needs, such as substance use. You know, you've got Marie and myself here today, obviously with intertwined work, We work very closely with Angela Constance, and obviously the substance use issue is a very important one, and somebody mentioned it earlier. So a cross-government approach in partnership with the managed clinical network, with the third sector as well, and as I cannot emphasise enough, those folks with lived experience to get this right. And we're looking to hold a stakeholder event in the very near future, designed to discuss ways to improve the quality and the consistency of support and services for women and families.
Thank you. Maybe Todd wants to come back in.
Yes, it was just when Kevin mentioned the delivery of services looking different in different parts of the country, I just wanted to say that the delivery of universal services has looked a bit different during the pandemic as well. So what we've seen is antenatal classes move to online delivery. We've also seen breastfeeding support groups move largely to closed Facebook groups and social media, and we've seen social media and virtual opportunities to connect mums and babies largely, but often, you know, families, and to encourage outdoor meetups, for example. So we've seen around the country walk and talk groups begin. And whilst that has happened because of necessity, because it's safer outdoors than indoors, and small numbers are safer than large numbers, all of these things, I have to say, I for one, as a public health minister, thinking about the general health of the population, the challenges we have around getting people active, the challenges we have around health, maintaining healthy weight, particularly during this phase of life, and how important it is for women to be a healthy weight during pregnancy and subsequent pregnancies. I do hope that that continues, so that opportunity to meet up outdoors and walk together, to socialise through exercise, I think is probably a very valuable step forward. I'd be looking forward to the day when it's not the only option, though.
Thank you. Gillian.
Probably following on from that, what action can be taken to ensure women and their families receive joined up care? And obviously that will look quite different just now, probably compared to what our ideal would be sort of after the pandemic. I'll probably come back to Marie Todd on that one first, please.
Yeah, so joined up care and a holistic approach to supporting women and families. I mean, I think you'll have heard that throughout the evidence that we've given this morning, it's a really, really important cornerstone of care in the perinatal period. We're taking specific actions to improve joined up services for women and families with complex needs, such as substance use. And also, you know, we've talked about that. We've talked about the Best Start approach. We have made an investment prior to the pandemic. We've made a significant investment to increase health visiting. So we've increased the health visiting workforce by almost 50% to build capacity and to provide more support to those individuals who need it. And, you know, that's a significant difference in approach in Scotland compared to the other UK nations. That's because we've recognised just the incredibly valuable role that our health visiting teams provide the new families, and we have invested in it and supported them with their role.
Can I come in the back of that? Because there was something specifically that did get mentioned from the women that we spoke to, and also people who put in written evidence as well, and that's about the support for infant feeding, and that when that support wasn't there, and again this comes back to this consistency of approach throughout the country, some places that particularly breastfeeding support wasn't there, or they felt that midwives didn't have the time to give them the breastfeeding support, led to postpartum, they feel that it added to postpartum depression issues. Minister, so what can we do to make sure that women feel supported? That real crucial, you know, feeding your baby keeps on coming up as being an issue. Mary.
Thank you, convener. It's a really important point, and I will probably bring in Caroline Wilson to give some more evidence on this. I'll give you some my own initial thoughts, though, as well. So it is a really important thing, and actually consistently pre-pandemic, you know, so for consistently for a long period of time, we've had far too many women who have given up breastfeeding, not because they wanted to or because they chose to, but because they weren't given appropriate support in the early days. So this is an issue that we have been working on for a very long time. In actual fact, so that I hear you that some women feel like they weren't supported well. The reality is, so the outcomes are that during the pandemic, breastfeeding rates went up. So the most recent infant feeding statistics, and it's very complex, isn't it, to unpick why that happened, and we're still trying hard to understand why that happened, but the infant feeding statistics show that almost two-thirds of babies born in the financial year 2021 were being breastfed for at least some time after their birth. That's up 1% from the previous year. More than half of those babies were being breastfed during their first health visitor visit, which is at 10 to 14 days, and 38% were being exclusively breastfed. Now, that's increases of 2% and 1% respectively from the previous year. The proportion of babies being breastfed at 6 to 8 weeks of age is now at the highest rate since records began. Now, it's still too low, in many would say. So it's at 45%, of which 32% were being exclusively breastfed. And that, again, is an increase of 1% over the previous year. So whilst I am absolutely, you know, I wouldn't dream of dismissing those women's experiences, the data show on a population level that actually we managed to get something right during the pandemic year in terms of breastfeeding support. And whether that's because fathers were often at home, whether that's because there were was more support provided virtually in people's own homes rather than having to go out and ask for help. I'm really not sure. We will unpick the details of that. Of course, all of this improvement comes on a background of real commitment to breastfeeding in Scotland over you know, decades, in fact. And again, Caroline may set the scene on this better than I can, but Scotland was the very first of the UK nations to achieve 100% UNICEF UK baby friendly accreditation, which is a really important landmark in terms of achieving breastfeeding, improving breastfeeding rates. You'll be aware, you know, there's massive cultural influences on women and families and whether they choose to breastfeed or not, and whether they are able to or supported to breastfeed. And the UNICEF baby friendly programme gave us very strong evidence-based practice in order to improve the rates of breastfeeding in Scotland. And I will hand over to Caroline now.
Yeah, bring in Caroline, and I'll need to move on to Evelyn Tweed's questions. Caroline.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. I'm just checking, can you hear me? Sorry.
We can, yes.
Right, that's fine. Thank you. So just adding to what Ms Todd set out there, we recognise the importance of that very early opportunity to breastfeed, and it's very important that all women get skin-to-skin care and get an opportunity to have that very special time with their baby immediately after birth. And we have set ourselves a stretch aim in Scotland to try to reduce the drop-off rates of breastfeeding at different stages. And we measure that at 68 weeks, but we look predominantly at what happens in the very early hours and days following birth. And that links into the maternal care, the maternity care that they receive. So we are well on our way to reducing that drop-off, and across the whole of the country, the number of women, as Ms Todd said, who initiate breastfeeding and who are supported to breastfeed for longer is absolutely increasing, and that's due to the increased financial investment, but also trying to understand more about what the support infrastructure should be around women to provide them with the resources that they need to continue to breastfeeding for as long as they wish to. So looking at that very early stage is really important, and I think the points that were made about not dismissing the individual women's experiences, but we do know there's been a lot more contact with our breastfeeding helpline, with some of our virtual support, and we know that infant feeding teams were largely protected as well as an essential service during the pandemic, and that's what we remain committed to do, because we know the importance of that tiered level of support, from peer support up to specialist support, to support women on their breastfeeding journey. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And it is those first couple of days that was highlighted to us as being a particular issue. Kevin Stewart, you want to come back in before I move on?
I'll be very brief, convener, because Ms. Mackay's question around about universality and accessing services. As the committee well knows, I have an ambition to ensure that we set high quality standards across the board in mental health services, and I've talked around about what we've already done with CAMHS, what we're doing now with psychological therapies. Here in perinatal, we are proposing to bring forward a service specification, which will be absolutely vital in ensuring consistency of care and promoting those joined up care pathways across Scotland. In so doing, we'll also look at national and local conversations with the third sector and those with lived experience to ensure that we get those specifications right, and we'll adapt them accordingly. So I think that again is a vital piece of work that we will carry out to ensure consistency of care across the board.
Thank you. And can I come to Evelyn Tweed? Evelyn.
Thanks, convener, and a good morning, panel. It was great to hear Kevin Stewart's opening remarks on the focus that the Scottish Government has on perinatal mental health services. However, the third sector advised that funding is often short term and fragile. How would you respond to this, Minister?
What I would say to Ms. Tweed is that to date we've invested £1.8 million in third sector services within the perinatal and infant mental health portfolio. We've publicly committed to investing up to £1 million per annum in third sector provision. A key part of our ongoing third sector work has been to invest in the sector as well as providing funding to specific organisations. I know myself from conversations that I had last week that none of this is easy, and that third sector organisations would prefer it if we could provide multi-year funding. I wish that were the case too, but of course, the Treasury, the UK Treasury, will not give us multi-year funding, and this is where it creates difficulties. We have given as much comfort, I think, as we can to third sector organisations. I certainly value the work that they are doing, and we will continue to work with them, do our level best to provide the resources, provide the services that women and families need right across the country.
Can I bring in Hugh Masters?
Just very briefly, I appreciate the time, just very quickly to add what the Minister said. The programme board has always had third sector. In fact, the first funding that was awarded from the programme board was for the third sector. So we very much don't see them as a separate section or a separate issue for discussion. As you see, it's come up all repeatedly today. What I would say is that we are both exploring how funding may continue beyond the life of the programme board, and that's something we'll focus on next year. But more importantly, we also work with a partner organisation, Inspiring Scotland, who manage the fund, but they don't just manage the accounting, they work with the third sector organisations in terms of how to make the funds last as such, and also to those organisations that aren't very versed in it about applying for further funding. So Inspiring Scotland have done a great job in working with third sector to try and make them as sustainable as they can be. Thank you.
Thank you. Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. And as we look forward, given the demands on the NHS, how does the Scottish Government see the relationship between the third sector, perinatal mental health services and the NHS developing in future? And if I could ask that to Kevin Stewart, please.
Thank you.
That is an extremely important question. What we require here, without doubt, in order to get this right for women and families across Scotland, is for complete cooperation and collaboration and a lot of communication between NHS boards, the third sector, and the voices of lived experience. That is the best way of ensuring that we do all that we can for women, their babies, and their families. I have to say that in terms of some of the third sector work that I'm aware of, it is crucial. And in terms of the developing of services at board level, third sector and the voices of lived experience should be at the very, very heart of that work in order that we get this right. So a very, very important question there from Ms. Tweed. So basically what I'm saying is communication, collaboration, cooperation, and then we'll get it right for people.
Thank you. Thank you. We move on to final questions from Emma Harper. Emma.
Thanks, Convener. Just I know that the Minister mentioned stigma in the opening comments and also took a question from Sandesh Gulhani about stigma, so I won't belabour it, but just I know the Government are doing a lot of work to address concerns and raise awareness with the public around perinatal mental health. And so just reading some of the issues here, tackling stigma and fears around perinatal mental health, including concerns that mothers might have their children taken away from them, is one of the issues that's been being addressed. And there are 12 action items in the perinatal mental health plan. So I would just, if the Minister would like to just elaborate a wee bit on specific actions that are being taken to tackle stigma.
Thank you, Minister.
Convener, I know that a common theme in the evidence that you've had was a concern from mothers that seeking help with perinatal mental health services could result in the loss of their child. So, you know, in terms of our tackling of that kind of stigma, it is extremely important that we get this right. So the forthcoming Raising Awareness Good Practice Guide will aim to highlight mechanisms to tackle this kind of stigma at multiple levels. We recognise that we cannot remove stigma by adopting one single approach to this, and that to be effective, stigma reduction needs to be tackled on multiple levels. Therefore, we must look at what works for different families, members of different communities, within the public, and within different groups of professionals. The modules that Ms. Harper has talked about earlier on perinatal mental health contains a specific module for practitioners focused on stigma to help inform professionals across Scotland to help ensure a consistent and empathic, a word that I should have avoided, empathic approach is adopted. I should say as well, because we've not covered this, every baby box in Scotland includes a leaflet on perinatal mental health. And this leaflet is currently being updated to include the latest information on where to seek help. Again, we're currently also working with CME to explore ways to actively promote role model and highlight good practice around stigma reduction and raising awareness across perinatal and infant mental health. And in addition, in February 2021, we ran a national campaign aimed at increasing awareness and reducing stigma around infant mental health called Wellbeing for Wee Ones. Without doubt, convener, this is an area that we need to do much more work in. It's an area where I think we need to cooperate together to ensure that we reduce stigma. We must do all that we can for women, babies, and their families in this sphere. And we need to get the general public to recognise that this scenario that folk go through could happen to anyone, and that you know, we as a society need to do all that we can to help women, babies, and their families get through difficult periods and hopefully reach a brighter future.
Okay, thank you, and that's a good note to end on. I want to thank both ministers and all their officials, as well as the many people who got in touch throughout this inquiry to tell of their experiences as well. We're going to suspend this meeting before we come back at 10:45. Thank you.
Thank you, convener.
Our third item today is consideration of the Transvaginal Mesh Removal Cost Reimbursement Scotland Bill at Stage 2. To make everyone aware, we have a substitute member. Millie McNair is substituting for David Torrance, who gives his apologies. And I welcome the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care to the meeting. But before we start, I'm just going to explain the procedure briefly for everyone that is watching us. There will be one debate on each group of amendments. I will call the member who lodged the first amendment in that group to speak to and move that amendment and to speak to all the other amendments in the group. I'll then call any other members who've lodged amendments in that group. Members who've not lodged amendments in the group but who wish to speak should make a request to speak by typing R in the BlueJeans chat function at that appropriate point, and please only speak when I call your name. If he has not already spoken in the group, I will then invite the Cabinet Secretary to contribute to the debate. The debate in the group will be concluded by me inviting the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up. Following the debate on each group, I will check whether the member who moved the first amendment in the group wishes to press it to a vote or withdraw it. If they wish to press ahead, I'll put the question on whether that amendment is agreed to. Any member who still wishes the amendment to be put to a vote, if the original member doesn't want to press it, will put an N in the chat box at that stage. If that happens, we'll then proceed to a vote on the amendment itself. If a member wishes to withdraw their amendment after it's been moved, they must seek the agreement of other members to do so. If any member present objects, the committee immediately moves to a vote on that amendment. If any member does not want to move their amendment when called, they should say not moved. Please note that any other member present may move such an amendment. If no one moves the amendment, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. Only committee members are permitted to vote. Voting will take place electronically using the BlueJeans online chat function. As convener, I'll provide instructions on how and when to vote, and these will also be relayed via the chat box. If any member has requested a vote on an amendment by placing an N in the chat function when asked if that amendment is agreed to, we'll then proceed to a vote on the amendment itself as follows. First, we will record votes for the amendment. Any member who wishes to vote for the amendment should then place a Y in the chat box when prompted to do so. Secondly, we'll record votes against the amendment. Any member who wishes to vote against the amendment should then press an N in the chat box when prompted to do so. Thirdly, we'll record abstentions on the amendment. Any member who wishes to abstain on an amendment should then place an A in the chat box when prompted to do so. And to enable the clerks to record votes accurately, please do not use the chat box for any other reason during votes. If you need to communicate with myself or the clerks for any reason during this time, use our private messaging group that we've set up. Once voting has been completed, the clerks will check the result and they'll pass that result for me to read out. Once I've read the result of the vote, should you consider that your vote has been incorrectly recorded, then please let me know as soon as possible and I will pause provide time for this. The committee is required to indicate formally that it's considered and agreed each section of the bill, so I'll put a question on whether each section is agreed to at the appropriate point. And I now begin stage two proceedings. I call Amendment 1 in the name of Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 2 and 5. I'll call on Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 1 and speak to all the amendments in the group. Cabinet Secretary. Now, we cannot hear the Cabinet Secretary, so I'm just going to allow broadcasting to get this out. Yeah, a little bit of crackling, but that's about it.
Can you hear me now at all?
We can hear you now, yeah.
Okay, I'm not sure what is happening with my headphones. Forgive me, convener, but if there are problems, of course, I'll log back in and perhaps without the headset, but I will not touch the setup I have here now, and hopefully hopefully you'll be able to hear me fine. Thank you, convener, and I hope you and all committee members are doing well this morning. Convener, section 1.3 of the bill currently defines qualifying mesh removal surgery as surgery for a person who's ordinarily resident in Scotland at the time the surgery was arranged. Concerns were raised during the evidence session at stage one that the criteria was too narrow in scope. It was felt that the eligibility criteria should be widened to allow those who were not ordinarily resident in Scotland at the time they arranged mesh removal surgery, but had been at the time of the insertion of the mesh. I gave an undertaking during my own appearance before committee on the 2nd of November to consider this point further. And certainly in response to the stage one report, the government agreed that the residents' eligibility criteria was too narrow and undertook to bring forward an amendment. So therefore, the amendments before you today will extend the eligibility criteria to include those who were not ordinarily resident in Scotland at the time of arranging their mesh removal surgery, but who were ordinarily resident in Scotland when the mesh was inserted. I mean, I hope these amendments will be welcomed by committee, and I move Amendment 1 in my name. In respect to Amendment 5, the bill is intended to allow reimbursement of those who have themselves arranged and paid for mesh removal surgery. Where mesh removal surgery is arranged by a health board, it is of course provided free of charge, and a health board would not normally arrange surgery for a patient who was not ordinarily resident in Scotland. For these reasons, the government cannot give its support to Amendment 5, but of course, as always, I would be very keen to continue to liaise and engage with Ms Mauchin in her explanation of these amendments she's tabled, and we can of course revisit this issue if it is required come stage 3. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Carol Mauchin to speak to Amendment 5 and other amendments in the group. Carol.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the Minister for his moving of the amendments. In moving Amendment 5 and speaking to all amendments in the group, I want to be clear I am very happy with the spirit of this bill and the very collaborative nature of the Parliament in moving this forward and through each stage to ensure the women involved are reimbursed at the earliest possible timeframe. My amendment, Amendment 5, is to ensure the broadest scope for the qualifying residence element of the bill. And as the Minister has stated, the committee have always agreed this is the correct approach. And Amendment 5, I think, ensures that if there are any women who have had mesh implant removal undertaken by the NHS, but not ordinarily resident in Scotland, they would be included in the eligibility criteria to allow them, if they were able to seek expenses, etc. The committee did, towards the end of our discussions, touch on this and the right of all women adversely affected by trans vaginal mesh surgery who had any surgery in Scotland. So therefore, in the interests of clarifying the bill and making sure parts of it are not unclear for those affected, I move Amendment 5.
Thank you. I'm not seeing any other members that wish to speak on this. Cabinet Secretary, would you like to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 1? And we've lost you again, so if you want to put that wire, you should go.
What I could do.
We'll maybe pause to allow the Cabinet Secretary to log broadcasting. Can we pause for a couple of minutes to allow the Cabinet Secretary to come back in and log back on?
Hello, can you hear me now? Hi, are you able to hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
We'll leave the headphones to the side, I think. We'll do it without it. But if you hear my daughter in the background having a tantrum, then my apologies in advance.
That's just life during COVID. We're used to it by now.
Okay, sorry about that, Convener.
That's okay. Right, broadcasting, just let me know when you want me. Good. Okay, we're ready to go. Thank you. So we've got a Cabinet Secretary back. I believe that you're not, you don't wish to sum up.
I'm happy, Convener, to waive the right, other than to say that I'm happy to speak to Ms Mochan off table if her amendment doesn't pass, to see if we can give any further reassurance in relation to Stage 3.
Thank you. So the question then is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Now, I just remind you that if you're not agreed, to put an N in the chat box and then we'll go to a division. Just give you a couple more seconds because it is looking like we are all agreed. That's agreed. We're agreed. Amendment 1 is agreed to. I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with Amendment 1. If I can get the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 2 formally.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question then is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Agreed, then put an N in the chat box. I'll give you a few seconds. Amendment 2 is agreed to. Thank you. I call Amendment 5 in the name of Carol Mochan, which is already debated with Amendment 1. Carol Mochan, can I ask you to move or not move Amendment 5?
Move.
Moved. The question then is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay, we're not agreed, so we will go to a division. Use the chat box, please, and all those voting in favour of Amendment 5, please type a Y in the chat function now. Thank you. And all those voting against Amendment 5, please type N in the chat function now. Thank you. And we, anyone wishing to abstain, please type A in the chat function now. The clerks are just finalising the vote. You just give me a second or two. Okay, the votes for Amendment 5 were 2 and against 8, and there were no abstentions. The amendment is not agreed to. Thank you. So I call Amendment 4 in the name of Jackie Bailey, and that is grouped with Amendment 3. And I'll point out that Amendment 4 preempts Amendment 3. Therefore, if Amendment 4 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 3. I ask Jackie Bailey to move Amendment 4 and speak to all amendments in the group. Jackie.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I'm grateful to you and the committee for the opportunity to move Amendment 4 and speak to both Amendments 4 and 3 in my name. These obviously flow from the committee's evidence session in prior to Stage 1 of the bill. Policy intention behind the amendment is fairly straightforward. It extends the eligibility period for women who have arranged surgery for mesh removal. The original cut-off date, members will recall, that was suggested by the government was the 12th of July 2021, and the committee was clear that to capture as many women as possible, we needed to be as generous and flexible with eligibility criteria as possible, and we didn't want any unnecessary barriers in the way of women accessing reimbursement. So the Cabinet Secretary said at the time that he would give the matter further consideration. So here I am with two amendments. Amendment 4 and Amendment 3 actually have the same effect, but are two different ways of achieving the desired outcome. It is very much for the committee to decide which it would prefer. Amendment 4 puts on the face of the bill that the qualifying date is for any removal surgery to have been arranged before royal assent and not specified in the scheme. Amendment 3 stipulates that the date will be specified in the scheme, but it can be no earlier than the date of royal assent for the bill. So ultimately, the difference is whether you want it on the face of the bill or you want it in the scheme. I'll move Amendment 4 at this point in time. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ms. Bailey. And I'm not seeing any other members who wish to speak on those amendments. So I'll go to the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you so much, Convener, and thank you to Jackie Bailey for moving, bringing these amendments forward, for moving them, and also thank her for being the only one that's clearly in the festive spirit with her backdrop. Can I speak to her amendments? I am grateful genuinely for Jackie Bailey for bringing these amendments forward. It was Jackie Bailey, as well as other committee members, but Jackie Bailey that pressed the government to consider whether or not the cut-off date of the 12th of July, which is when I announced publicly the completion of the first stage of procuring an NHS referral route to private removal surgery, was that the right date to have in place? And I thought that committee members, but also most importantly the women affected who you took evidence from as a committee, I thought their arguments were very persuasive indeed. And I've always said, ultimately, for this bill not just to meet its primary purpose, but to seek to try to bring some justice to the women involved, then the voices of those women must be central to any of our deliberations on this front. And I also absolutely appreciate that there's been a delay since the initial announcement in July, and it's taken some time for contracts to be completed. Now, that's not because of any application of goodwill of the parties involved. Far from it, they've been engaging very well and helpfully in negotiations. But it's no doubt that these are complex contract negotiations. And I fully accept, having met a number of the women involved, that the delay in completing those contracts has undoubtedly caused anxiety for women who have suffered for far, far too long. And the government doesn't want those women penalised for the fact that contract negotiations continue to make progress, but of course are taking their time, excuse me, to work through the intricacies of those contracts. So I'll confirm now that the government wishes to add its support to Amendment 3 brought forward by Jackie Bailey. And confirming our support, we hope too that there's a consensus in the committee and more widely that the scheme shouldn't be open-ended. There should, after the cut-off date passes, it should be that all the options put in place by the NHS, including referral to private providers, we should offer women the support and the choices they need. So we need to have a date that is not open-ended, but I think committee would probably agree with that. The government considers it's reasonable now for there to be an extension to the cut-off date for the scheme to include time since July to around the time of royal assent. I did take notice of Amendment 4, and Jackie Bailey thought some well. I do think Amendment 3 is better because it retains some element of flexibility given these particularly uncertain times. I think it would be sensible to keep open the option of adjusting the cut-off time if there was some unanticipated development. As I say, good progress is being made with the two private providers in terms of contracts, and we're confident that surgery in the independent sector will be available from early next year. So in closing, I thank Jackie Bailey for tabling Amendment 3. I confirm again the government will support it, and I hope with that support that allows Ms Bailey to withdraw Amendment 4.
Okay, and with that, I'll ask Jackie Bailey to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 4. Ms Bailey.
Thank you very much, Convener. There's an important lesson in politics, as in life, which is to quit whilst you're ahead. So can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his support? On that basis, Convener, I am content to withdraw Amendment 4 and press Amendment 3.
Thank you. Okay, so I call Amendment 3 in the name of Jackie Bailey, already debated with Amendment 4. And Jackie Bailey, to move or not move Amendment 3. Ms Bailey.
I move Amendment 3, Convener.
Thank you. The question then is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? If you're not, use the chat box and put an N. It appears we are agreed. So Amendment 3 is agreed to. I now call Amendment 6 in the name of Carol Mochan, which is grouped with Amendments 7, 8 and 9. And I call on Carol Mochan to move Amendment 6 and speak to all amendments in the group. Carol.
Thank you again, Convener. In moving this group, Amendments 6, 7, 8 and 9, I clarify again my amendments aim to be helpful in ensuring the spirit of the bill in the discussion of the committee and captured it is captured in the final bill. Amendments 6 and 7 seek to add wording that will give clarity at this part of the bill. The committee did seek to ensure eligibility for someone incurring costs and supporting someone to have treatment, and this is covered in my Amendment 6 and 7. This would allow this to happen. Amendment 8, this amendment is to extend the bill to cover those who may have begun the process and had costs, but unfortunately the process has halted due to travel restrictions or surgery restrictions in relating to coronavirus. And Amendment 9 is a simple amendment, just laying out the meaning for coronavirus for the state of the bill if passed. So I move Amendments 6, 7, 8 and 9 and seek the support of the committee in what is quite a straightforward amendments.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. I'm not seeing any other members wishing to speak on that. Can I come to the Cabinet Secretary?
Thank you, Convener. And can I echo what Ms Mochan has said about how this bill has been, how the passage of this bill has been collaborative and constructive. And although I will be resisting Carol Mochan's amendments, I do want to make an offer to her that if they do not pass, then of course I'm more than happy to work with her between stage 2 and stage 3 to see if we can give some effect to some of the concerns that she may well have. I'm grateful for her explanation of the intention behind her amendments 6 and 7, and I want to assure that the bill as drafted do cater for the circumstances that I believe she has in mind. In section 14A of the bill, it states that qualifying costs are, and I quote, as charged to or in respect of the person who underwent surgery. The words in respect of therefore already allow for expenditure by someone other than the patient to be taken account of and reimbursed. So if a person who is not the patient has directly paid part of the cost of surgery, then evidence of that expenditure can be submitted and of course can be considered for reimbursement as part of the claim by the person involved, by the patient. As I noted in the Parliament on the 24th of November, we expect that applicants may well want to claim reimbursement of costs and then pay back any money available to them or spent on their behalf by family members or friends. The draft scheme which has been provided to the committee does include some important details on that point. Paragraph 17 of the draft scheme clarifies that money received from public fundraising campaigns must be declared in the application and may be deducted, but costs that have been met directly by another person may be included in an application, and it will be for the receipt of any reimbursement, the recipient of any reimbursement to distribute that money they received. So for example, if a sibling paid for surgery on behalf of the patient, this expense could be included in the patient's application. And of course, once the patient receives the reimbursement, she could then repay her sibling. I should also say that I do have a worry that Ms. Mochan's amendment could lead to people who are only slightly connected to the patient making an application for reimbursement in relation to the patient's surgery. I appreciate that will not have been the intention, but I think in general it would make sense for applications to be made for or on behalf of the patient and their supporter, and then allow any private monies to be repaid. I hope that clarification is helpful to Ms. Mochan, and hope therefore that she will be content to withdraw Amendment 6 and not move Amendment 7. In relation to Amendments 8 and 9, Again, I'm also grateful for the explanation. I do, of course, appreciate the plans of patients hoping to arrange mesh surgery. They may well have been disrupted, particularly in the times that we live in. My officials are aware of a number of cases, as committee members will no doubt be too, but the government isn't aware of any circumstances where travel has been actively curtailed in the way envisaged by the amendment. That said, we do consider that there's and in the draft scheme more than sufficient flexibility to deal with individual circumstances.
Look like we might have
made lost impossible as a result of the decisions of foreign governments, then it is to be expected that carriers will have either refunded the costs or offered an opportunity.
Right, broadcasting, we may have to suspend briefly because we have lost the Cabinet Secretary. If we could suspend briefly while we just check the connection for the Cabinet Secretary and get him back in. Thank you. We appear to have resolved our technical difficulties. I'll just check we've got the Cabinet Secretary back with us before I move on.
Hi, Convener.
We do. Thank you. And I think we heard your summing up there. So I'm going to ask Carol Mochan if she would like to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 6. Ms Mochan.
Hi. Thank you, Convener, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary. I appreciate the discussion around the amendments and accept that there is time at Stage 3 before Stage 3 to discuss these again and make sure that we get it right for people. I will withdraw 6. Do you want me to go on, Convener?
No, I'll prompt you with the other amendments. So you're withdrawing Amendment 6. I'll then call Amendment 7 in the name of Carol Mochan, to already debated with Amendment 6, and ask Carol if she would like to move or not move Amendment 7.
Not move Amendment 7.
Thank you. Call Amendment 8 in the name of Carol Mochan, already debated with Amendment 6, and ask Ms Mochan to move or not move Amendment 8.
Move.
Moved. The question then is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed. Right, they will, we're there for, we've got a division. So if you just stand by and again use the chat box. If I can ask all of those in favour of Amendment 8 to type Y in the chat function now. Thank you. All those voting against Amendment 8, please type N in the chat function now. And all those wishing to abstain on Amendment 8, please type A in the chat function now. Thank you. So the clerks will now finalise the vote. The results of the vote on Amendment 8, we have 4 members for and 6 against and no abstentions. The amendment is not agreed to. Right, we move on to call Amendment 9 in the name of Carolyn Mochan, already debated with Amendment 6, and ask Ms Mochan to move or not move Amendment 9.
Not move.
Thank you. Right, then the question though is that section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed on section 1. And the next question is that sections 2 to 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. And the last question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?